My name is Michael Ikeogwu. Today, we are looking at the topic, the World Press Freedom Day. Let me first of all congratulate media practitioners across the world for being steadfast in the course of discharging their responsibilities in spite of the harsh weather we find ourselves. There is no gainsaying the fact that the Nigerian economy, to a very large extent, is not conducive enough for the practice of journalism. This is as a result of the infringements meted out on journalists who are on a daily basis out there sourcing for news for public consumption. These infringements range from unwarranted arrest of journalists, attack by the state attacks. When I mean state attacks, the security agencies, even the politicians are not left out. Community leaders, village heads, and what have you, have not fared well as far as the freedom of journalists in this country is all about. These are, and more other issues, are what we are going to look into in this episode. We have in the studio three gentlemen to help us look at this all-important topic. By my immediate left is citizen Zika Chima.
Yes.
He is of an NGO.
Yes.
Fighting for the human rights in Delta State.
Yes, it's my pleasure being here.
We also have Comrade Ejime Udueme. He is of Delta Broadcasting Service here in ASABA.
It's a pleasure.
Then by my far left is Comrade Akpokona, Omafuaire, Esquire. Akpokona, you're welcome.
I'm humbled.
Thank you very much. Ejime, in 1766, the Swedish government came up with a policy that will allow media practitioners, even printers, writers, to air their views unhindered.
Yeah.
And we're made to understand that the advent of other forms of printing led to that.
Yeah.
But precisely in 1993,
yeah,
the UN came up with a resolution to celebrate press freedom on May 3rd. And this today is May 3rd, and that is why we are gathered here, to look at the freedom of the press,
yeah,
particularly in the climate that we practice. How will you describe the freedom you have enjoyed and your colleagues as media practitioners in Nigeria?
Yes, we say it is worth celebrating because we have seen the bright and the dark side of journalism, globally speaking. When you talk about World Press Freedom Day, I think it's a day that journalists should roll out their drums and celebrate, because we know that despite the harsh economy that we are faced with today, journalism practice all over the world has gone through thick and thin. In the sense that in the practice of journalism, you have the good, the bad, and the ugly. And it's more worrisome in the present day that we find ourselves, that you could be in your bedroom, you could be anywhere, and you call yourself a journalist. The greatest challenge that is faced in the profession, as it were, is that of quackery. Because we know that for you to be called a journalist, you would have gone through the four walls of schools where you'll be trained on the norms of the practice. But today, so many persons who are holding sway appear to have been saying in the scene of journalism without going through the rigorous process for them to be called a journalist. But I know that a day such as this is a platform where we could sit down, fraternize, brainstorm, and find a way on how journalism practice could be repositioned to meet the aim and purpose for which it was established. When you talk about freedom of the press, I think in the present day parlance, I have to say clearly that the freedom is not what it should be, because there are so many inhibitions to the practice of journalism. Are you talking about government? Are you talking about policies and programs and so many other things that will hinder the practice of journalism? But by and large, I am of the opinion that generally speaking, journalists have gone through rough and very difficult times. When you talk about the military junta here in Nigeria, so many journalists were jailed. When you talk about the present day democracy, they came up with so many things to gag the press. And a situation where journalists are being gagged. When you talk about freedom, you now know that the freedom is no longer 100%. A situation where you could air your views and some persons will see it from another angle that you are being antagonistic. I think stakeholders in the media industry should use a day such as this to think, come out with resolutions on how some of these inhibitions could be addressed. Because if it is not addressed now, when we have democracy, is in when it goes the other way around, even when we don't pray for the unexpected to happen. But you know that in life, it is either for or against. Because we are in democracy today. So many persons are also learning that some of the ills in the democratic dispensation that we are in, they could be thinking that there is need for the military to come in and correct some things and go back to the barrack. But as much as I know that we don't pray for the military to come on board, I also think that journalists and journalism practice should be given freedom as it were for them to really do what they need to do. Because in the issue of agenda setting, I know that there are certain things that one would want to do, but some persons will perceive it as being antagonistic. So in that direction, I also think that today being World Freedom Day is a day where all of these issues should be looked into with a view to finding the way
forward. Thank you very much. Of course, you are a media practitioner with the Vanguard newspapers and a lawyer. To you, what does this day mean to you?
It's a special day for the journalist. It's a special day for all practitioners of media. Now, but one thing we should get clear is that when we talk about World Press Freedom Day, there is no freedom that is absolute. We should get that clear. There is a limit to the freedom a journalist enjoys. We have had challenges, like Comrade Ejime said, most especially during the military regime. And even in the democratic setting, we still have issues. Journalists are still having issues in the course of carrying out their job. I have suffered attack in the course of doing my job before. Series of other people have their own experiences. Like the guy in, there's this guy in Cross Rivers or so that asked a question. And a politician attacked him for asking questions. A colleague in Abuja got killed the other day. We don't know the reason behind the killing. They said it was accidental, whatever. We know that it is because of, as a result of doing his job.
Yeah.
Now, the only good thing is that freedom of the press is provided for in the modern law of this country. The Nigeria Constitution provides for it in section 39, sub 1 and 2. Now, if it has a legal backing, then the government of the day should stand up, because they swear to defend the Constitution. If there is a law backing the operation of the press, legally backed by law, then there should be more provision towards the practitioner attaining or enjoying that freedom. You know, inhibition should not come at all, because there is a law providing for it. So practitioners should enjoy it. Then when there is infringement on the right of pressmen or press freedom, the government of the day should take it upon themselves to an act. But generally, we could say it's fair. The journalists, media practitioners in the country, in our state here, to a reasonable extent, they've enjoyed freedom, so to say.
Okay,
thank you.
Zika, I know you are from the CLA, and you have made use of the media in championing your cause.
Yes.
What constitutes press freedom?
Press freedom, as today was declared in with respect to it, was actually a United Nations declarative proclamation for the practice of journalism across the globe.
Yeah.
Will I agree with me that the press is as important as life itself? The press is as important as politics itself. The press is as important as the economy itself. The press is as important as living itself. And so to that extent, you ask a question, why did it become expedient for it to be declared, to be given a day like this? Press freedom is the exercise of unencumbered liberty for journalists to publish what is right, to publish what is verifiable, to publish what are factual. And so anywhere, like I said, it sometimes truth hurts. And so when some people in power, you know, find information relating to them in the negative sense, they become agitated. And sometimes they take it beyond just agitation to unleash, you know, violence or hurt on the practitioners. But the truth of the matter is, the journalism practice, and indeed press freedom, whether you like it or not as a man in power, is a necessary evil, if you like to call it evil. The truth of the matter is, you cannot do without a press. The press is important in all ramifications of our life. The press is the very, very nucleus of our existence, without which the society will collapse. Because the activities of government, the activities of organization, the activities of mankind, all ever in every way you can remember, the messages are conveyed, disseminated by the use of the media organs. And so what you find is, today being declared World Press Freedom Day, what it means is that it's in recognition of the very, very sterling service that the media renders to mankind. And no person can take that away. We in the human rights community, we are joining to celebrate, and we are saying that we are collaborating with the media people, because even among the human rights community, there are also many people who are media practitioners. And so we are happy today was declared, and we are celebrating it. And for those who do not want to see journalists, I'm sorry to say that there is nothing you can do about it. You have to find a way to tolerate them, because the ethics of the profession enables them to practice unencumbered. And the only thing that you can do is to find a way around, you know, changing your ways to be acceptable. Because what is evil is evil in the perspective of the journalists. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think the essence of the day is to re-emphasize the need for journalists to practice their trade unhindered.
Yeah.
It is also to raise some questions affecting the practice of journalism, as it were, across the globe. We also use this day to celebrate some journalists also who have paid the price,
the supreme price,
in the course of doing their job. I think these are some of the major reasons why this day is declared for journalists to celebrate the World Press Freedom Day. Akpokona, when you were speaking, you mentioned of the political actors, this government, to help enforce this freedom. But you will agree with me that more often than not, the people who perpetuate infringement on the rights of journalists are state actors, either those who are holding position of power, or the people who are enforcing laws, the security agencies, military soldier, that is the army, the police,
the future,
yes,
the time they see,
and even the civil defense. You are asking those who are perpetuating infringement on the rights of journalists to enforce it. How do we get that done?
No, generally, you know, enforcement of law or enforcement of rights does not dwell with the executive. It dwells in the judiciary.
Yeah.
So when the right of a journalist is infringed upon, the onus is on the journalist to approach the court where he can actively seek for redress of his right. Because when I mentioned that the executive now, those in power, should help to maintain this fresh freedom, I mean that they should give a backing wherever there is any infringement. They should take it upon themselves also to say, maybe to deprecate the action of such security agent or politician or whichever person that infringes on the right of a journalist. It will give the journalist a sense of protection and recognition. Just like what happened some years ago when a council chairman attacked me and the commissioner was there. The commissioner reprimanded the council chairman for doing that, you know, and they came to appeal to the leadership of the union. And I think that one gave a sense of protection too to me when I was doing the job. So that is what I mean. But if there is incident of infringement on the right of any journalist or a practitioner, the place to address it is in the court. They should seek redress in the competent court of jurisdiction.
So, Ejime Udueme, can you tell us some critical areas where you can summarily say that a journalist's rights has been infringed upon?
Our comrade here stated, I know in the course of monitoring this fuel scarcity, one of our staff talking about Unice Meyazer was beaten up, manhandled, the camera smashed at one of these filling stations in ASABA in the course of doing her duty. I also feel that journalists, in the course of carrying out our assignments, most times, maybe because of what some journalists may have done, either knowingly or unknowingly, some persons are always threatened each time they hear that a journalist is around and they are carrying out their assignment. They are always being on the offensive, trying to know what are you doing here and all of that. You could be invited for an assignment. It gets to a level where you will even be excused to be asked to stay outside. Now, once we are done, we'll call you in as if they now want to doctor the information that you should get. But under the normal circumstance, as a journalist, you should be given unhindered access to events, whether it is public or private. I know that there are times they say you are invading somebody's privacy. But as a journalist, if you have the requisite training, as it were, you should know where your right ends, because where your right ends is where another person's own starts. But in that regard, most times when we are carrying out our assignments, because of the fact that you now see yourself as a journalist, you now think that you are not a respecter of law. At times, a journalist could be driving on the highway. You meet policemen who are on stop and search mission. Some of us will even want to insult them. Why are you stopping me? Don't you know that I'm a journalist? But in that regard, you could also know that in carrying out your assignment, whether your vehicle was stolen or not, by mere stopping and identifying yourself, if you are asked to bring out this and all of that, you comply until you see them veer off track. That is when you now tell them, do you know that I'm a journalist and all of that? And as soon as you mention that word, a journalist, any policeman who is on duty, who is littered, who knows what you could do with the power of the pen, will even pause and give you that honor of saying, okay, you are a journalist, let me see your ID card. If you identify yourself, you are allowed to do, you could be excused, you could be allowed to move on. I know that in the course of doing our work too, if security men sees you as a journalist, whether you are there for good,
what constitutes an infringement on the right of journalists, just in a simple
term? Okay, the thing that constitutes infringement of the right of a journalist is when you are prevented from doing your official assignment. If I am there, say for a political rally, to get the news that I need to get from that assignment. In the course of trying to enter the venue, I am barricaded from entering there. Invariably, they're already infringing on my right because I have the right to cover such an event. It's only when I'm there and I start constituting news as maybe you see me fighting with another person, trying to push my way through and all of that, unruly behavior is seen in me. It's on that ground that you could be able to enforce some form of law where I could be pushed and asked to be of a good conduct.
It's like let me
add to his point. Most of such infringement comes, especially when there is election. When you are going about on election day, because of, you see security people blocking everywhere. Sometimes they see you with your branded vehicle, and so Dama has told us in Warri before that nobody is allowed to move on election day. But we said we are journalists. He said, whether we are journalists, everybody must obey the law that we don't move. We must. You know, that is infringing on our right because it's our duty to go and monitor election, to tell people what is happening. Then on environmental sanitation day, some policemen or security agents, they don't even know that a journalist has the right to move to monitor the sanitation exercise. I've been heard in several occasions that you cannot move. The former council chairman in this circus that I had is a supervisory councilor had issue with me for moving on a environmental day. I told him I'm a journalist. He said, where's my ID card? I brought my ID card. They seized my camera. They seized my ID card. I have to call you, the state chairman, to intervene. So that is infringing on my right because you are obstructing me. You are stopping me from doing my job. I think that was the point.
First and foremost, let us understand that journalism is a profession,
yeah,
and it is guided by certain regulations,
yeah,
and it is practiced under certain ethical bearings.
Yeah.
And so, when a journalist is properly trained, especially the mainstream journalists, it's expected that in the course of their practice, they conduct themselves in a manner that should instill some, you know, dignity. You know, or respect, let me say, you should be able to get attract respect from people around you. And I know also that the moment you identify yourself as a journalist this time, whether of the print or the electronic media, what it means is that you are there in public interest.
Yeah.
And if people, be they security agencies or whatever, if they are there for whatever assignment, they should be able to come, you know, they should be able to interface with you to enable the public get to know what has transpired. If you chase away journalists in the course of their job, you have infringed on their right to the practice of journalism. If you, you know, if you stop journalists from conducting their service or whatever, what it also means is that you are denying the public access to information. So there are many things that go with infringement. It, sometimes it may not be just physical assault.
Mm.
Denial of service is part of infringement. And you also trying to censor or gag what the journalist should do is part of infringement. You are not trained as a journalist. So you have no reason to teach a journalist how he should do his job. The only thing you can do, which I always say, is find a way around it to appeal to the conscience of a journalist. If you feel you have done something wrong, for example, if a politician suddenly pulls his shirt and engages in a fisticuff with anybody and it is covered, it is not right for you to go and seize the camera. For what reason? The man is there to cover whatever that interests him and within the practice. So what you need to do is to find a way, get around to him and say, please, my brother, this happened and I just like what happened in Anambra State during the inauguration. You saw how they tried to, but then, because of the social media impact,
yeah,
the thing was all over the place. But what am I saying? There are cases, I remember one particular incident in Lagos when Rebu of Newswatch, you know, they went for a ceremony or something, and at the end of the ceremony, they called him, they said, where are the press boys? And I think that, let me bring it to the conscience and the knowledge of journalists. Those in power, they believe that they are up there, and the journalists are just people who go for the crumbs.
Yeah.
And so when they just say, where are the press boys? The press boy is actually not supposed to be derogatory. But they see it in the context of, these are small boys,
yeah,
whatever we give them a
take. Them,
so I also expect that the way journalists conduct themselves matters a lot. that is why you find that even among those who are professionals, the journalists are the most poorly paid. It is not because their job is less in relevance. It is because that is the perception of the public. And so, let the journalists conduct themselves in a manner that will bring honor and dignity. And I also want to, you know, advise people in power, whether it is in business, because there are people also, whether you are bank MD, whether you are industry chieftain, whatever they are, you cannot function without the media. It is important.
Yeah.
There is nothing you can do, especially when you are within the public domain. It is important to respect and do not act in a manner that will portray you in bad light. If you infringe on the right of a journalist, if it will portray you in a terrible light, if you conduct yourself in a way that is, it will endear you to the public and indeed those that you are serving. Thank you.
Okay, Ejime, yeah. Most times the political actors see journalists as enemies rather than partners in progress.
Yeah.
I give you an instance. You come up with a story that ordinary is the reality on ground, but because of the interest of that political actor, he will want to call you all sorts of names to say you didn't do well. How do we manage the situation so that there can be mutual understanding between the practitioners and those who are putting them positions in trust for the public?
I think just as my brother stated here, journalists need to conduct themselves in a manner that people will see you attract respect and honor. A situation whereby some person's story is doctored by how much they were given. Once you do it the first time, the second time, the third time, when you appear at an assignment spot, especially somebody that you have written something against, we just see you. He already has a perception about you. Let's do our assignments and our job objectively, because if people know you that you are a truthful person, you are an upright writer, and whatever you write, you verify it, they will have implicit confidence in you. But a situation whereby you'll be found wanting in one way or the other, is it about your appearance? Is it about your body language? You are in a political gathering, more so when you know that we are in a situation where we have multiple political parties. You're already fraternizing with party A. Maybe you are coming to an assignment where you now wear the face cap of an aspirant or a candidate. In that regard, you have taken side. So you can't even be addressed as a journalist. In that case, you're already partisan. You understand? So I want to submit here that as a journalist, let's see the professional aspect as the core duty. When we stick to the ethics of the profession, we will earn the respect that is expected of us. And on the part of the political class, be it in public and private sectors too, I want members of the public to see journalists as their own brother, as their own friend, as their own colleague. Because if you see somebody as your friend, you will not be antagonistic towards such a person. When there is this mutual relationship, I think in executing our duties, it will flow as it were. And when we do our job, people will see the sincerity in that job. But the situation whereby you see that social color is black, but in an attempt to suit what you want to do, you want to play foul play, you want to tilt towards a direction, in that regard, the essence of you being a journalist is defeated. And such a person, whenever he or she sees you, will no longer see you as somebody from a standpoint where objectivity will be seen in whatever you do. So when we're able to regain that consciousness, that confidence that is expected of us, people will have that confidence that each time we are at an event, we will do it as objective as it ought to be. Let's not see brand envelope as the only reason why we are there. You get to an assignment, you see some journalists, what they are interested in is on a don't write name. He's not looking at the storyline, what actually is happening here. There are some too. You know that there are some assignments where some persons are invited. If you are not invited, and you crash into such an assignment. I believe that such a person should be more conscious of what is to happen here as far as the storyline is concerned, not who is in charge of giving journalists money, who is to address journalists after the main event. In that regard, once you are seen in that light, people will now think that if I don't give him money, or if I don't give her money, not giving him money or not giving her money will dictate the angle where this person will pick his story from. That is the nucleus of the matter.
You want to say something?
Yes, I want to contribute, but let me say this clearly. A trained journalist is like a lawyer. The lawyer in the court, whether he's defending a criminal today or he's prosecuting, is doing his job.
Yeah.
He does not, he's not a party to the quarrel between the parties. Let people also have this understanding that a journalist is someone who goes out to carry news. And what is news? Anything that is information that will pass, this is what happens. This is what happened, whether Mr. A was fighting, you understand, and the journalist got there and he got the story. That should not be perceived that the journalist has written against that person. Because I want to clear, let us to clear this particular point that somebody has written a story. It's not written against you. The person has written, he has reported story. You understand? Because the foundation upon which media work is built is what? It's facts. It's facts. Balanced reporting. If the thing did not happen and the person manufactured, that is not news reporting. That is become propaganda or blackmail or whatever. But if it is news, two politicians are fighting and you are there, you take your picture, you write your story, that person should not perceive you as have written against the person. That is what people are saying when you come. For instance, there are many political parties. And as a journalist, for example, I report for Vanguard. If party A calls me, they want to do delegate screening or whatever, and I go there, you should not look at it that this person is working for that party. No, the person has gone to report news. So the society should get this very clear that the journalist is not, he does not have interest in anything.
It's not for anybody.
It's not for anybody. Everybody, yes. He's doing his job. He's bringing news to people to see what is happening. Okay. So, and again, the news value of the particular journalist should not be dictated by your own perception. Because, for example, maybe you go for an AGM, and the purpose of your goal initially was for you to report AGM. Yep. But when you go there, you see the board of director fighting. That is a very oddity, make no news to the journalist. So it is, if for example, that God forbid, that the state, a dog bites a common man in the state, they will not make a good news.
Yeah.
But if it bites someone like the state governor, for example, a commissioner, it will become a news because it's oddity. If a woman gives birth to 100 children today, it could be a news. Woman gives birth to 2 children, it's not really a news. But if a woman gives birth to a pussycat, I tell you, it will go viral because it's oddity. So that is the new value to the person. Now let us get that clear. Then, issue of ethics should be sung on a daily basis to every journalist. Let them be aware. Let journalists carry the ethics of the profession like a creed that must be read daily. That is why you see the people in the law profession, ethic is taken very seriously. I think it is high time too in media practice, issue of ethic should be taken seriously because with the advent of new media, where everybody with a smartphone is not a journalist, somebody will just go and concoct something, they will tell you the government has endorsed this, when the government has not spoken. No balancing of reporting, all those issues should not even be entertained. So we must harp on that. And there should be more. People should also take time to train themselves. With the changing, things are changing every day. So people should read broad, should go for training, seminar, workshop, so that they get what is happening. But let us call that impression. Journalists does not write against, that is my opinion. I don't see that when you report something that somebody did wrong, and you now say that the journalist is my enemy, is writing against me. No. And again, too, there was an issue I wanted to draw attention to, where a journalist was trying to do investigative reporting by exposing fraud. And so people now went to send assassin to begin to attack them. But that is infringing on the right of a journalist. But we should get we should know the work of a journalist so that we should not perceive them as a necessary enemy where they are not.
Okay. I think the people who see journalists as enemies are basically those who have something to hide.
Exactly.
Because sometimes when you call a journalist to report an event, maybe a marriage ceremony, journalists will have free hand to even report after report, you can even eat. But take a step to unravel, what is it called, an investigation that somebody have allegedly collected 50 billion without executing the contract. The way they will see you will be quite different from when you go and cover a wedding ceremony. You understand? Because truly, there may be element of truth in that allegation. So they wouldn't want you to have access
to that information.
So they would do all manner of things
to
ensure that they frustrate you. There comes the issue of
FOI.
Freedom of Information.
The Freedom of Information Act. How, to what extent have you, the practitioners, been able to use that act to unravel the misery behind some of the story deeds that the political class is doing?
Akpokona. Okay, let me, you say something, eh? There is a foundational problem with our people. When the right of a Nigerian is infringed upon, most time we look at the process of getting justice from court, of getting redress. I beg, let me not just waste my time to go and pursue it. If not, if you have information that there is fraud committed in one ministry, in one place, in one organization, and you go there to demand, please, I am a journalist, I want to get access to social information. If they are denied by the provision of that act, you are supposed to seek for a redress, to enforce, you apply for such information to must be provided for you, your rights. You understand? But because of the nature of the country, bad leadership, failure of institution, everything has failed. So people just want to, let me just do the one I can do, and that is it. That is the truth. People are no longer serious to go the extra mile to say, this is what I will do. Like what happened to during the era of people like the Delegiwa and others, where they will tell you, people can, and even organization too, they spend money for journalists to go for investigative reporting. They will sponsor you, go there, it could take you even 3 months. 1 year, you are investigating one particular thing until you come out with the who does that now? They won't give you the funding. Look at the issue of Omore, that lady that was killed in Akwa Ibom, and one journalist, what is his name again now? This guy did, he took time, he even went to the telecommunication company to track calls made to that particular line and all that. And then what happened? Powers have been were saying that the guy was just doing this and they tried to cover everything up. You understand? So, back to what we were saying is that people are no longer willing to go the extra mile because the encouragement to do the job is not there. I remember colleagues sometime going to investigate the fire. There was this Chevron fire in Kuluama. Down the extreme end of Bayelsa. Do you know the cost of taking boat from Yenegua to that place to and for almost 100,000? How many people will pay? People who? But you know, if your organization gives you that backing, and okay, my friend, go, you have the money, you go there, you'll be able to give appropriate report, exact report of what happened there, not what the company is telling you. But these are the issues.
Okay.
The
organization we are talking about, some of them are not paying salaries. Let alone empower you to go and do investigation.
Okay, in addition
on the particular issue.
Yeah, in addition to what you have said, I think that our welfare packages are not something good to write home about. Because just as you pointed out, so many persons who are in the private sector, talking about journalists, many of them are not receiving monthly stipend. Some of them are even working as contract staff where the money you make aside is what is sustaining you. And another angle to it is the fact that when you go into investigative reportage, there is always threat to life. because you are trying to uncover so many things that may have transpired behind closed doors. And we're talking about the issue of fraud. Maybe you are trying to you are trying to unravel all that happened. You go to banks, you track courts, you do this, you do that. As soon as the person who is concerned hears about it, he will, if he's not the one to execute the plan, his voice will be after
commission
you.
Voice.
It's like now that we are in the political era, you could see an aspirant, maybe by virtue of what he or she may have done in the past, he may have gone to prison, not known to so many persons and all of that. You as a journalist, you get wind of such information. You now start by way of coming up with little write-up on that issue. As soon as they know that what you are saying is a fact, it's only God that will save you. More so when we know that here we have porous security. You could even confide in some security personnel that so person is after me. Please, I'm just confiding in you. You'll be surprised that the next day, such a person will put a call across to the person you are talking about to say, please, so person say you after them. Anything way they do, they fast so that it no go outsmart you. You understand? So, are we talking about life insurance? How many of us?
I told you that.
And you have 3 children, you have 7 children, you have dependents, and who takes care of them?
There's a lot of things that I've introduced to you, but you have not been able to take the opportunity to be short.
Yes.
Zika.
Yes.
There is no how a society will produce better journalists when the society is corrupt. Yes. There's this saying that you can't be looking for a heady mouth, a heady teeth in a rotten mouth.
It's not possible.
To this extent, the environment of journalism practice in Nigeria, vis-a-vis what our Esquire has said here, about the rigorous route you need to take to get justice.
Yeah.
The inconveniences you will incur, lack of funds to pursue such a case, and other issues that may crop up as we are embarking on this journey. Do you think our environment is conducive for journalism practice?
Every society gets the journalism practice it desires. I look at the practice of journalism in Nigeria as a very, very beautiful one. The society makes it interesting to practice journalism. The society makes it quite attractive to practice journalism. No matter what anybody says, you know that there's what they call the hard news. What makes it more interesting news? Negative news,
yeah,
in journalism. That's the one that creates more attention. That is why when they say, I was trying to come in, and let me come back to what you say. They said, in journalism, they say, when a dog bites a man, it's no news. Mm. When a man bites a dog,
that is the news.
That is the news. You know what I'm saying? And so, I want, like I said earlier, it is important for the journalist to conduct himself in a manner that will attract respect. Today, what you now see all over the place, you see journalists writing in a manner that they intentionally write in a manner that attracts government patronage. Every journalist today is working towards being appointed an SA on media. It's not even because of the passion anymore. I want to tell you this. It is difficult for me to meet somebody who is appointed, who is invited by a governor. Because I remember a friend, Bumiga Ogunle, my very good friend. We did together. He rose up to the point of becoming the editor of the Guardian newspapers. He edited Punch, you know. And when Lawal, the first in 1999, Rear Admiral Lawal, the editor of Kwara State, invited him, he's a Kwara State indigenous, and said, I want you to be my commissioner for information. He said, give me some time to think about it. And the next day, the governor called him and said, the passion I have for journalism will not allow me to serve in your cabinet. I don't want anything that will stop me from writing any day of my life. And so, Your Excellency, sir, I decline. I'm telling you.
So how many people can take that?
That was what till today. That's integrity. He's presently the provost of Nigerian Institute of Journalism. He got a job with Arik Airline, and they were paying more than 2 million naira per month. But he discovered that the team was interfering with his writing this thing.
It's possible.
He just threw it in. He said, "No, this is not what I want."
No.
You know what I'm saying? That is the kind of, anytime he went for a function, bank or whatever, as soon as they finish and they are giving this brand envelope, they go, "Call him, ah, baby, come." He said, "My company has taken good care of me. I don't need it. Thank you." I walk away. Others will just be scrambling. And today, I want to tell you something. If you get your card, if he gets a card to anyone in government, they respect him because his integrity is known all over the place. They say, "Ah, who is it? What kind of man is this?" But what am I trying to say? If people write in a manner that they want to get government patronage, you are no longer doing the job in tandem with the requirement, the professional ethics. Because everything you are doing is tuned towards getting the attention of people in power.
Infrastructure.
Beautiful. You see today, you see the media people, all of them from morning till night, they stay in government house. They use government house facilities. They feed from government money. So what kind of report are you going to make? What kind of report are you going to make? Can you want to report against the man who takes care of you every day? When you don't wake up, the place is just... You go to a lot of state correspondents, you cannot hardly meet them in your offices. Go to government house. For God's sake, if you want to practice journalism, your business going to government house, if there's a press conference or there's an invitation to cover an event, you go there, you go back to your place. Your company should be able to provide the facilities. All the things that you require to be able to perform optimally. That is what it should be. And it is because of that, like I said earlier, that is why people look down on the profession. People in power look down on the profession. Ordinary people, even these days, even when you go to a garage, motor park, and for whatever reason you come, you say, "I'm a journalist," they say, "Ah, I lie people." People say it with so much demeaning, you know. So what am I saying? I know that journalists are underpaid, grossly underpaid. But I want to say something. If you don't like water touching your body, get out of the cleaning business. If you don't like the heat, get out of the kitchen. If you must practice journalism, because I've already said it, integrity in journalism is what brings you money later. If you go with the intention that you want to make money, then you will fall on the wayside. It is the integrity that you have built over time that will now, people will now begin to invite you. "Please, I want you to do this for me. Please, I want you to do this for me." And they will rely on whatever information you pass.
Yeah.
But if they know that all you do in the course of your service is, "I'll be waiting there for your boys now when you finish." For God's sake, what stops you from after news conference, you walk away. Do it 2-3 times. And you see how people begin to talk about you. They could disparage you, they could castigate you, but those whom you have rejected their offer will recognize it and say, next time, they could even call you privately and say, "Please recommend 3 people who want only 4 media houses. Recommend 3 people. That is how you build your career. That's how you build respectability. You know?
Yeah.
So my brother, I believe that we need to do a lot more. One, the badgers are bastardizing the journalism practice. What I mean the badgers, those who are not trained. And that is why if you go, Ruben Abati, before he was appointed the chairman of the Guardian listing, the Guardian newspaper, he was a member of the editorial board. They say he must go and get, he already had his PhD, but he must go and get a PGD minimum in mass communication, journalism or whatever. And he had to go to Nigerian Institute of Journalism. Having been a member of the editorial board of the Guardian for more than 6 years, he had to go and get a postgraduate diploma. You can't be a principal today or be a vice president in Delta State or anywhere in Nigeria if you don't have education certificate or diploma. That is what you should be. But what do you see? If I ask all the correspondents here, if the governor asks them, "Let me see," there are more than half who don't even have any training in journalism. And so, thank God you are here as the chairman of the NUJ. These are the things that need to be done. It's not about somebody reading history. If you read history up to PhD level, for God's sake, if they tell you to describe how a newspaper is produced or how news is produced in the electronic media, you'll be looking. It's
So that is, those are the basic things. It is when you get into the training in a forum that you begin to appreciate these are the ethics, these are the sensitive areas. You understand? Otherwise, it will just be all commerce profession. And it is very important that we begin to sensitize the people. Very, very important. I want your own tenure. That should come in place.
Okay. Thank you very much. I think we are doing something in that direction. We will pray that God will strengthen us to do more and ensure that we deliver on the mandate you have even given to us now. Please, with our time constraint,
in summary,
why does political actors go physical rather than following the process of the law to seek redress?
If you ask me so, you know, it has to do with individual, because they feel that when a journalist is physically ruffled or physically intimidated, next time when he wants to deal with that particular person, he's going to be more careful. I think it's a kind of a threat strategy.
Okay, thank you very much. What is your message to journalists as we celebrate World Press Freedom Day?
Journalists across the globe, I want to commend us once more on a day such as this. I want us to continue to put in our best, do the job in accordance with the ethics of the profession, so that at the end of the day, people, the society will have confidence in us that we are really trained and we are imparting on humanity.
Zika.
Yes, the journalism practice is a beautiful one. For those of you who have the ambition of coming into it, feel free. Be different from the crowd you think are not worthy of emulating. But today I want to wish journalists all over the world, you are part and parcel of society. We enjoy what you are doing, and we are saying the human rights community, they are standing by you.
Thank you very much. My name is Michael Ikeogwu. Join us in town tomorrow.